So what is up with the weather? Brian Kahn joins us from Climate Central. And Brian, explain this to me. Is this an El Nino or is it not?
That's the great debate. Right now, we're still in this El Nino watch that's persisted since March. It seems like this El Nino has played a bit of a hide-and-seek game with us, where it looked like it was building over the course of the summer, and then signs of it just kind of disappeared, and now they're finally starting to reappear. It's still a bit early to say that El Nino is officially here, but signs are certainly pointing to the fact that it should form in the next couple months.
But what do scientists need to prove that it is an El Nino or it isn't?
Well, they pay attention to a couple of different factors. One of them is certainly the temperatures in the tropical Pacific, and they're starting to see those temperatures line up to what they would consider an El Nino. Mm. They also consider other types of effects in the atmosphere, and they're seeing those things start to line up too. The big thing that they're sort of waiting for is that those things are starting to line up, but they haven't really been in place for quite long enough for scientists to officially say, yeah, we're looking at an El Nino right now.
Yeah, so remind us, since we haven't had the El Nino effect for a little while here, remind us, what is, you know, all politics is local. I want to know how this is going to affect me if it really is an El Nino.
Right, well, there's a number of impacts it has. You know, one thing to know is that it's guarantee that certain things will happen, but it sort of tips the odds in their favor. So if you're in the Southwest, you're likely to see wetter than normal conditions. The Southeast is usually wetter and a little bit cooler. And then the Northwest tends to be on the warm side. I know a lot of folks in California are certainly banking on El Nino to help bust the drought there, and there's sort of good and bad news about that, which is that the good news is that El Nino can break up droughts there and bring heavy rains. The bad news is that it generally happens in El Nino years that are really strong El Nino years, and right now the way things are looking, this year isn't going to be kind of that blockbuster El Nino that would bring, you know, a higher chance of heavy rains to California.
Yeah, and here on the East Coast, I mean, we would feel the effects as well, possibly?
It has a little bit of a less effect on the East Coast, certainly in parts of the Midwest. In the East Coast, there's a couple other climate factors at play that will affect, you know, these big-scale weather patterns. And science points that at least through the fall, this area, as well as, you know, a large part of the rest of the U.S., is going to see above normal temperatures, or at least the likelihood is increased. There's no guarantees of those things, but certainly other things could nudge the climate one way or the other.
Okay, just a quick thought here, Brian. I mean, is this the sort of thing that will become permanent then if you come to now expect flash flooding in places like Arizona?
I wouldn't say permanent, but it certainly is a possibility throughout the fall and the winter. You know, another thing to consider too is that it's not just a question of how much rain falls; it's also, you know, where it falls and if there's a lot of, you know, impermeable surfaces, like we saw in Phoenix with the two tropical storms that have kind of hit it recently. That leads to major flooding. So it's a combination of a lot of things, both you know, what's going on with the weather, and then also you know, how we're building things and the type of places we live.
Brian Kahn is with us from the organization Climate Central. Thanks so much.
Thank you.